I really did have no idea where it could go, though. I just got loved being involved and working with them. It was a step. I wasn't even thinking about, certainly wasn't thinking about money. It's a shame, really, that it finished when it did. It's a shame for my bank balance. But
today, some people say, oh, I don't remember that group from the 60s, I don't remember them. I mean, people can't remember every band from the past, but if you just sort of hum a few bars of Sunshine of Your Love, they say, oh, yes, I remember that tune, I remember that riff. And then, of course, they know who you're talking about.
Right up there with, you know, sort of Purple Haze and later on, Whole Lot of Love, All Right Now, it's one of the greats of all time.
Well, I guess that the hallmarks of Cream's material during the period when Pete Brown was writing most of the material was the fact that he introduced some very clever original lyrics which tackled topics that you wouldn't normally associate with a rock band.
Cream as an entity were not an atypical band. They'd been in atypical outfits and done session stuff and that, but this was much more of a, you know, based in blues rock, but was going to go sort of like a total fusion on stage.
He gave them, took the pressure off them when it came to delivering songs. Songs were done because he could help with the lyrics and it was easier. And they were, because they were such great musicians, all three of them, it made, let them room to just concentrate on the music.
He'd started out as a beat poet back in the early 60s. And this was something that Pete Brown did. He would actually go around sort of taking part in sessions with jazz bands, jazz musicians, reciting poetry to music.
His lyrics are very visual and they have a very visual content and they paint a picture, in a way also quite obscure, so that psychedelic sort of psychedelia meets rock meets madness is quite a good thing because they're quite obscure and quite poetic, but they're very pictorial as well, and I think it went very well with what was going on at the time. I mean, we were in the middle of a psychedelic thing. It was the 60s, total madness, everyone going bonkers, taking everything, doing everything.
He was some kind of this whack job, brainy intellect guy, this very colorful, obviously well-read, full of images. I don't know if it was from LSD or he just was naturally born a little bit different than the rest of us, but he had this great imagery.
Yeah, I've always had this theory about especially about things like acid, which I've never knowingly taken, which is that acid made some people with no imagination feel that they had an imagination, which was perhaps for some people that was nice. But what they did, unfortunately, what acid did was that people that had an imagination and that took the stuff quite often got pushed over the top.
You've got to be careful with him because he writes things and they come true, you know, so you have to be nice so he writes nice things, you know, because sometimes he writes kind of a bit heavy type things and they come true, you know.
The important thing really is the collaboration with between Pete and Jack Bruce. They formed a great songwriting team. And this is a time when Eric Clapton hadn't really developed as a songwriter himself.
In some respects, Clapton, I think, felt on the outside. Clapton ultimately would become more of a songwriter, but it was always Pete and Jack as sort of this collaborating kind of twosome that ultimately would make Eric feel left out. And ultimately, I don't know if that's what led to it, but ultimately Eric breaking the band up at the height of its popularity.
I remember when I was writing for Melody Maker, suggesting once, wouldn't it be great if you had the kind of dream band? I think we called it the Beat Group, something like that. The Beat Stars Beat Group, where people voted for their favourite musicians. And among the winners were Jack Bruce, Ginger Baker and Eric Clapton in each of their categories. So the seeds were kind of sown in that sort of thinking in the 60s. The early 60s, we talked about beat groups and pop groups, but we didn't really talk about rock groups. The Beatles weren't a rock group as such. Their music, their instruments were used to back the lyrics in the songs. Whereas with Cream, the whole idea was to integrate their technical skill.
There's no substitute for people really being able to play and also having a sense of musical history and being about being able to look at various, to find various good influences and incorporate them into what they were doing.
And also, they were presented as a popular band, not a pop band, but they were popular. So for the first time, bands like Cream appeared on Top of the Pops. Bloody hell, you know, what's all that about? You know, and it was like, we had this sort of jazz rock fusion band on Top of the Pops, you know. Wrapping paper, bloody hell, what's all that about? And that's what made them special. It was the first time a band like that became major popular. In the city, feeling pretty, down and out and making love to you on the shore. Shattered windows, stairs to nowhere. In your picture as I gaze ahead and don't see that they're calling, that they're calling. Wondering sadly.
Eric, you have a large and growing fan following here in Britain, and I think that they expect a certain kind of music from you, a kind that they didn't get on your hit record Wrapping Paper. Would you agree?
Yeah, I would agree, because we did want to surprise them in a way, because we didn't want them to sort of just, you know, accept us as just a blues band. We wanted to be something more than that, you know.
Yeah, well, you certainly did.
They had a couple singles out, really, before the first record came out. They did it, their first single was a song called Wrapping Paper, which I believe was suggested to them by Robert Stigwood, who was managing them. Stigwood was a pretty important guy in the scene. He had been working with some bands, and I think he wanted to give the band some kind of really commercial kind of song to start with. And it really sounds like this Bing Crosby ballad that Jack Bruce croons. There's no guitar. If you didn't know it was Cream, you wouldn't know.
Whether the idea was to produce something radio-friendly, instilled by their manager, maybe it was his idea to do that, I don't know, but certainly it didn't do them justice.
Although it sounded like them, it wasn't the Cream that you'd expect to release a single like that. Wish I knew what you'd done to me.
Turn me on. The reason it was put out was obvious, is because it was the nearest thing they got to an obvious single. It was came from the first recordings, and like everyone in those days, they wanted to put out a single first to test the water.
I remember when the single came out, I was at Melody Maker with my colleague Nick Jones, who was also a great fan of Clapton and Cream, and rushing in to play the single. I'm sort of looking at each other and thinking, well, what's this? You know, it's rather a weak song.
I was very preoccupied with movie images, especially the idea of ghosts and the things of ghosts in movies, you know, always fascinated me when they were on the more poetic side, you know. And so the idea of this weird idea of two people that can only meet in a picture, on the wall of an old house, which has got all sorts of weird Hollywood, old romantic Hollywood connections and strange kind of ghosty movies, you know. Just came and it seemed to work.
Definitely a track I would suggest people actually go and listen to. And I think they'd be mildly surprised, if not greatly surprised, at the richness in the track.
I don't think it fits on an album. That's why it didn't go on an album. It makes sense for me, you know. Great record, but whether it's a classic really is down to people's opinion. Well, I bought the first album, Fresh Cream, as soon as it came out, because I went to see the Cream at the Ricky Tick in Hounslow just after they'd done some European stuff they weren't even heard of here. And there was 150 people, and they hold about 400 or 500. So I went out and bought the album. Well, it was a blinding record. And then I went back 1 month later, and they were queuing around the block. And it was just like, bang.